So far, we have a game where you can shoot a singular enemy and you can be killed by that very same enemy. But currently, there is no way to score points. So we want to add more to our UI, and we want to add the ability to score points and represent that inside our UI as well. Okay, so what I want you guys to do is to take a look back at your hierarchy, and we are going to look at the HUD canvas. So the HUD canvas is our UI canvas. As you remember earlier, we placed in the health UI, which gives us the slider for our health and the little heart icon, as well as the damage image. But this time, we're going to create a score text. So what I'm going to do very quickly is just at the top of the scene view, click the 2D button to switch back to 2D mode, and I'm just going to zoom right out. Or what I can do is double-click my HUD canvas to frame it, and then zoom back in. What I'm doing is selecting my rect tool, because whenever I work on UI stuff, I want that fifth tool.
Show us the 2D button again real quick while you're zoomed in.
Why not? There it is.
There it is.
2D button. Once we're in 2D mode, we can then go ahead and create some more UI. So this time we're going to make a child object of the HUD canvas. Therefore, I'm going to right-click it, go to UI, and text. So these UI things are basically a collection of ready-made objects that you can start working with. All of the things that are in the UI system, much like the rest of Unity, are actually components. So what we're really doing is creating a new game object with a text component attached to it. By default, when you make a new text component, you make something that is kind of default aerial text, and it is in gray so that it will kind of work neutrally on light or dark backgrounds. So we're going to go ahead and rename this. So the first thing we're going to do is call text score text, so capital S and T. So rename text to score text. Then what I'm going to do is to re-anchor this to the top center of the screen. So if you remember previously, we learned about rect transform's anchor presets. And the way that we're going to do that is just to set the anchor, rather than all of it, to the top middle, or top center, I should say. So it's this preset here. So we don't need to Alt, we don't need to Shift, we just need to click that singly. And what that does is moves our anchors to the top. So you can see our little flower pattern thing is now sat at the top. And from there, we can then adjust the positions as appropriate. You'll now notice that because I've moved those anchors, the Y position is minus 220. So the center of the game view is minus 220 pixels, or units, from the top. So now I can say the Y position is going to be minus 55, and I'll make sure that my X is also on 0.
That moves the text in relation to the anchor.
Yeah, so right? Let's just reiterate. If I set that to 0, you can see that the pivot is 0.5, 0.5, so it's in the center. But if I drag this down, you can see that I'm moving it a minus value. So I'm going to put that around minus 55. So then the next thing we're going to do is set up the width. I'm going to set the width to 300. And I'm going to set the height to 50. I'm going to set the color to white. So in the text component, you have all the controls for how the text displays. And I'm going to drag in that color picker so that my color for the text is white. Then, because we don't want it to just be aerial and very small, we're going to set the font. And we're going to use the circle select and choose luckiest guy. So that's a font that we've included in this. So if you're not used to doing any kind of UI work in Unity, because Unity is authoring another game or application, effectively you need to include that font within your project. So we have the TrueType file for luckiest guy within that. So we have the license for it, and we have the font itself. That means that when we export, it will have the font and use it. It doesn't work like word processors or Photoshop. It won't just be able to pick from your library. You have to create a copy of the true type within your project. So our score text has that font, and we're going to set the font size to 50. And we're going to use the alignment under paragraph to center and middle. So center and middle and font size to 50. And you should see that we have new text written in there. Obviously, we don't want it to say new text. We want to see what our actual score will look like. So in the text field, I'm going to type in score, colon, space, 0. That's the default that it's going to look like when we start the game.
Also important to know that we don't necessarily have to set the text to say score, colon space zero, our script is actually going to write what it is that text should be. However, it's really hard to tell what this is going to look like when we're playing our game without putting some value in there. So you might say later, well, why did we set that text when the script is already doing it?
Yep.
The reason is so that we can visually see, okay, that looks pretty good. Now let's go ahead and apply our scripts and do the rest of our stuff. So just a placeholder.
Yeah. So now that we've done this, I'm going to go ahead and save my scene. So file save. And the next thing we're going to do is to put a slight drop shadow. So there are some effects that come with the UI system, and we can add them as a separate component. We can keep the score text selected, go to add component, and just type the word shadow, and it'll immediately find that component, and you can hit return. So that will just give you a slight drop shadow. I'm going to make it a bit more obvious by changing the effect distance to 2 minus 2 in the X and Y axes.
It's also important to keep that use graphic alpha checked. Otherwise, if you change the alpha of the text, the shadow won't also change.
Yeah, so what you'll notice about this is that if I change the alpha of the text itself, the shadow underneath is also fading out. Whereas if it's not checked, we can fade this and then the shadow will get left behind, which is not desirable. And then we need something to actually set the score. We need something to be managing the score, updating the text component's text value with score 10, score 20, whatever happens in the game. And the way that we're going to do this is by adding a manager script. So what I'd like you to do is to look in the scripts managers folder, and you'll find our score manager. We're going to drag and drop this onto the score text game object. Then, once you've applied it, you should see it at the bottom of the list of components, right underneath the shadow, and we can double-click to open that up.
So at the start, we again have our public variables, but you'll notice there's a new keyword there, static. So a static variable doesn't belong to the instance of a class, it belongs to the class itself. So let me explain. Whenever we're dragging on enemy health or player movement onto an object, we're creating an instance of that class and applying it to the game object. So they're all instances of a class. And so all of the variables, they're instance variables. They're all like, each enemy has its own health. Each player has its own speed, etc. Static variables do not belong to an instance. They belong to the class itself. So what that means is, in order to reference the score there, we don't need to go score manager, variable score manager, get component score manager, then use it. We just say score manager type dot score. So we don't need to create a variable to use it. We're just going to use it through the type itself.
So it only effectively exists in one place. We're not going to address a bunch of instances where this exists. We're changing it in one place, right?
Yeah. We could still have multiple instances of score manager. We could drag multiple ones onto a game object, onto different game objects. Doesn't matter. We're not going to, because that would break everything. But if we did, all of them would share the same score, because it belongs to the type, not to the instance. So the next thing is, of course, we need a reference to our text component. In Awake, we're going to set up that reference to the text component. Then, of course, we need to reset the score, because if we die, we want the game to reset. So we need to set the score back to zero. And in our update function, what we're doing there, that text.text, is we're changing the text property of the text component. Okay, so the text component that we have, that string that we said score colon space zero, that was the score text. That was the text property of the component. So what we're doing is we're setting that to a completely new string. We're not changing that, we're just setting it completely afresh. And we're changing it to score colon space, and then that number will be the score.
So very simply, that's our score manager. And if you happen to save it for any reason, it'll ask you to convert the line endings. It's no big deal. Okay, so we're going to need to continue scoring points. And I'm going to select my Zumbunny in the hierarchy and locate the enemy health script. And we're going to open the enemy health script and have a look down at the very bottom at the start syncing function. So James mentioned the public static integer score earlier, and he promised you very kindly that you could indeed say the name of the class scoreManager.score. So without saying get component, create an instance of the script, assign to this part of the script, we can very simply just say scoreManager.score. So we're going to re-enable that by deleting the two forward slash comments. And what we're doing there is adding to it the value of score value. So score value within this particular script is a public variable that we can change. So this enemy has a value of 10 that when you kill it, you get 10 points. This way, we can apply this enemy health script to different enemies and have different score values. So if you wanted to make the killing the elephant worth a lot, then you could change that value. You don't need to go into the script and change it. It's a public value, so it appears in the inspector.
I just want to make a quick point about static variables. So you know, it's a lot easier to do it with static there. Like, we didn't have to create an instance variable. We didn't have to assign it in awake and then use it. We just used it just like that. So why don't we use it for everything like that? That would be so much easier. It's because we have multiple enemies, and if we wanted multiple players, then we'd have more of those as well. So if we wanted to change the health of one player, all of the players' health would change. So we can't do it most of the time. These just very specific circumstances where you'd only have one score, so we can make that static. Yep. To make it easier for ourselves.
So we're going to save this. It's going to ask you to convert line endings. Just choose convert. This project was made on PC and then moved between PC and Mac, so the files get confused, but it's no big deal. So we should now go ahead and try it out. So if you save your scene and press play at the top of the interface. There we go. 10 points for a Zombunny. A very important point to make right now about prefabs is that they are incredibly useful when you want to spawn more than one object. So some people might use it for rockets in a game, you might use it for enemy spawning in a game, you can use it for really anything you want to. But we want to use that for our enemies. There's going to be three types of enemy, and you guys have gone ahead and created that first enemy. So what we don't want is the enemy to just be sat next to the player when the game starts. So what we need to do is to save him as a prefab. So everybody, make sure you've stopped play. So play is no longer on. It should be
no
black
blue
at
buttons.
The top. No more blue buttons. What we're going to do is to select our prefabs folder in the project, and then grab the Zombunny in the hierarchy and drag and drop it into the project panel, either in the empty space or drop it onto the prefabs folder. Both of those will create the same effect. You will get a Zombunny prefab, which looks like this. And you will have all of the same settings that you had on the version that's in the scene. So that version in the scene now belongs to that prefab parent. And even if we delete the version in the scene, in the hierarchy, then the version in the project is saved. And that's very crucial. We can now, everybody check that you've got your Zombunny in the project, very important. Then in the hierarchy, we want to get rid of it. So I'm going to select it there, and on Mac, Command Backspace, on PC, just the delete key. Remove it from the scene. And then save your scene. Switch off 2D mode and double click the player to zoom back into the action so you can see the player. Okay, so that is the end of phase 8.